Hello, my soccer universe. Nothing makes you healthier than winning a European group stage. Unbelievably, honestly. I really cannot fathom it, to be honest. Let's talk about the game before I put it into perspective. It was clear from the get-go. I actually had a very good feeling. I think the best performance of LASK this Europa League season was the one in Lisbon when they totally outclassed Sporting and still managed to lose somehow in a way that I still don't quite get, to be honest. That for 5 minutes they played and they scored two goals and we should have scored. Like, you know, we had three times as many shots and all that kind of shit. So, yeah. I knew there's a good chance to beat Sporting. It did get better when due to suspensions and, you know, the fact that, you know, they already qualified. Sporting did not field their full squad, and LASK will always is fielding their full squad because they take the Europa League a lot more serious than most others do. Although I wouldn't understand why Sporting is not taking it 100% serious, but, you know, the championship is probably more valuable in Portugal in a way. So those were good signs. Also the weather and the fact that Sporting Lisbon in their history have never even won in Austria. I mean, in Lisbon, I think 1 point for Austrian teams, if at all, I think all Austrian teams lost there, and then it's the complete opposite. And there's crazy games. I mean, this would be a video, Sporting Lisbon against Austrian teams in itself. That's worth doing. So I felt quite comfortable. The game itself started kind of the nice thing is about fireworks at the beginning. The tifo was all right in that stadium. You cannot make a good tifo. We'll talk about a great tifo later on. But yeah, the game started kind of slow. Yes, typically LASK having more initiative, but Sporting could hold it at bay, and it came around the 20th from a corner kick that, you know, there was a shot that was such a bad miss. But corner kick, we're going around over the ball. Michael pulls it in, and our captain, Trauner, heads it into the net. Dead ball situations are a specialty of LASK. No doubt about that. Then Sporting actually had a good chance. And I still have to say, by itself, the jerseys that Sporting was wearing by themselves are horrible. However, when you see them with the entire kit, with the light blue light green pants, it actually looks pretty cool, I have to say. I really have to say that. So then, you know, they had a chance which was muffed. Trauner was not only scoring on the front, he twice with very well-timed tackles prohibited Sporting from launching goal the second. I have to say, he has been outstanding, absolutely outstanding for most of the season so far. He might not be the fastest player, but his positioning is so well that I don't know why he's not a regular international team. Yes, we have good defenders, but I think he's as good as most of the defenders we have in the national team, with the exception of Hinteregger, who plays for Frankfurt. We'll talk, not necessarily more, by the way, we'll talk about Frankfurt later. Then a decisive situation came when a pass of Holland to the side goes to João Klaus, who is clear on goal and is taken down by the goalkeeper, who actually pulls out his hand. He still gets the shot off, which is cleared off the line, but the foul is a penalty and it's a red card for the goalkeeper. Long time changing. Klaus steps up, puts it right down the midline. Man, so much, the goalkeeper is not there. And it's 2-0 LASK, and at that point you just have to say they're cruising. I did not feel that this is gonna go any other way. You're 2-0 up, a man up, it's not gonna much happening. In the second half, I mean, there could have been a third goal, but it was in the second half, and again, LASK, I mean, they were playing around the box, it was like handball. The funny thing is that Sporting had a proper round around the 60th, their biggest chance, when I don't recall the name now. He was running onto the goal, rounded the goal, goalkeeper, but a little bit too heavy of a touch, like Lukaku almost, and then he couldn't pull it in, although from a very acute angle. And just a few minutes later, the biggest chance for Lusk in that second half, when a corner kick again for Michael goes at the center of the box, but just outside, you know, where the circle is, and Ramftel volleys it from there. A little bit too central on goal. That would have been a wonderful goal. Then, you know, the typically two strikers come on. We have basically again four strikers of equal value. So Ragutz comes on and he actually makes a goal. It's ruled out for offside, probably the right decision. And then I think probably the teary moment of the evening when Emmanuel Pogatetz, Mad Dog, played in the Premier League even and had many games for Austria, spent his last few years now with Lusk. He even played in the early fall season because one of our main defenders got injured. So he came on for basically his last game for Lask and probably his last international game because he's now going to the amateur levels to play out his career. And he was celebrated. I mean, the only thing I thought is it would have been nice if he would have made a goal. Speaking of which goal, there was a point, I think Pogadets was the only one. Every player of Lask in this game had a shot on goal. Every player, except the goalkeeper. Every player had a shot on goal. Just wrap your head around this. This shows the dominance and also the teamwork in this team. It's absolutely amazing. I mean, what they built in those 6 years since they took over is absolutely, absolutely remarkable. Ragutz gets his goal very late. Celebration was a little bit angry, so I don't know what was exactly happening there. So, and I have not heard anything to the positive or negative that was said. But yeah, it ends 3-0 for Lusk against Sporting. They win the group. They are seeded in the draw, more in the draw later. And it's, I would argue, of everything happening in this European season, I think Lusk is the most surprising story. We were a number four seed ahead of the draw. I think I thought if we were good third, we will come third. It will be a good task. Maybe with some luck we can challenge. Yes, we did have luck. That we get Eindhoven right at the point where there is Malen injured and Bergwijn injures himself in the game against Lusk, where we were lucky. There's no doubt about it. That was definitely lucky. However, on the other side, you gotta win those games. I mean, going to Sporting, well, Sporting was admittedly very much down at that point, but still, you gotta pull that off. And considering where we were and where we came from, it's pretty remarkable. It's pretty remarkable winning this group. Yes, it was also, we played now a B team, but it's still pretty darn good what they have been doing. So I'm quite happy. To round out the group, Rosenborg got the first point, 1-1 draw in Eindhoven. So Eindhoven's season ends kind of on a sour note, it has to be said to be fair. So the group ends with Lusk finally claiming top spots, 13 points, Sporting 12, Eindhoven 8, and Rosenborg only 1 point. Let's run through the other groups one by one, and we'll start in Group A. I did not see of all the groups all the action, but where I can, I will comment on it, especially the German groups I know quite well. So in Group A, Apoel gets a win over Sevilla, so Sevilla for once does not win, and Karabakh-Dudelange ends 1-1. I think Dudelange had the lead there, so in that group we have Sevilla with 15, Apoel 10, and Karabakh 5, Dudelange 4. Then a really interesting group was Group B, where Dynamo Kiev Lugano was for the longest time a lead for Lugano, which was good news for both Copenhagen and Malmö. For the simple reason that it didn't matter what the result was then in that group if Kiev doesn't win. Kiev only in stoppage time gets the goal. For the longest time, it was the match in Copenhagen was a really, really tense affair. The tifo at the beginning from the Copenhagen fans was just amazing, I have to say. And the game, yeah, Nord, good. There was a lot of atmosphere there, I have to say. I like the parking stadium a lot. In the end, Malmö gets the win, and they win this group ahead of Copenhagen 9, Dynamo Kiev 7, Lugano only 3. In Group C, Basel beats Trabzonspor 2-0 to secure their group, and Getafe late gets the goals second half against Krasnodar 3-0, so it's Basel 13, Getafe 12, Krasnodar 9. Trabzonspor makes only one single point. We talked about Group D. Group E was Lazio needed help. Lazio needed to beat Rennes and Celtic to beat Cluj. It went the exact opposite way. Total disappointment. I don't get it. Maybe Lazio is again focusing too much on the league instead of the Europa League. This seemed to be a group that they should easily advance out of. They do not. They lose 2-0 to Rennes. Completely deserved. And Cluj in the second half gets 2 goals against Celtic. And those two move on. And if you look at the entire group stage, fully deservedly so. Then huge drama in Group F. We knew that Arsenal was sort of safe. They needed to lose by 4 goals or 5 goals to be in trouble. But it was between Standard and Frankfurt. And Frankfurt at home to Guimarães starts with a very unlucky 0-1 for Guimarães, where there was a foul in the Frankfurt half. And then it gets 1-0 for Guimarães. Frankfurt then gets a very lucky equalizer, where the goalkeeper just lets the ball through his hands. I don't know how that happened. And then they make it even 2-1 over the half. At that moment, everything is cruising for Frankfurt. They seem to be on their way into the next round. Standard then starts to dismantle Arsenal, gets a 2-0 lead, and it was quite deserved. I have to say, the Arsenal kit, I like the navy, but the pants do not match. That, I think, is a mistake. So they start getting a 2-0, and then only late Arsenal puts 2 back in very short succession, where it was actually a warm meltdown of Standard. Standard would have deserved the lead. It was actually a danger that they get maybe the 3 or 4-0. It is 2-2. At that moment, Guimarães suddenly gets a 2-2, or again, kind of goalkeeping mistake, and then they get few minutes later in the 3-2. I think that was then a really deflected shot. At that point, Standard is only 1 goal away from advancing. Absolutely crazy. The games end, and Frankfurt doesn't know whether they advanced or not. They lose at home, but Standard makes only a 2-2. Frankfurt just squeezes past, and they were cruising at one point. Group G. Probably my favorite group out of them all. But it ended with a crazy game in Porto, where Porto first threw a horrible goalkeeping mistake and an own goal leads 2-0. Within a few minutes, Feyenoord equalizes, and I think in the 20th, Porto makes it 3-2. That there were no more goals scored is kind of sad. But this was a really, really interesting start to that to the group with that win. Porto was through. Rangers also got the lead against Young Boys. Young Boys too little too late. They get the equalizer. They would have needed a win to advance. Unfortunately, Young Boys and LASK have a friendship, so it was more for Young Boys in that one. So Porto, Rangers, Young Boys, Feyenoord are the last. Espanyol loses at home to CSKA. And in a head-to-head, Ludogorets takes the lead against Ferencváros. They give up a goal. It ends 1-1, but it's enough for Ludogorets to advance behind Espanyol. Ferencváros misses by a point, and CSKA Moscow is in last place. Group I was also kind of boring. Ghent gets the 2 goals early. Alexandre puts one back late. Wolfsburg through Otavio, a former LASK player, gets the 1-0 over Saint Etienne. Horrible gray jerseys, I have to say. That didn't look good color-wise. But yeah, it is. They both get the win, so it's Ghent ahead of Wolfsburg. Now, the other group with loads of drama was Group J. Between we had Roma at home to Wolfsburg and Gladbach ahead to Başakşehir. Where to start? Well, let's start in Rome because very early on, I mean, it was an even game and the Twitter between those two was crazy. Wolfsburg sends a Twitter message to Roma with the Colosseum. Hey, we're at the stadium, but we cannot find the bus entrance. And Roma twitters back. Well, guys, you're at the right spot. We're coming. We will see you soon. Hilarious. Absolutely hilarious. Well, the game was anything but. Roma took TX lead through a penalty. I think it was Perotti. But an own goal from Valencia equalizes shortly thereafter. It's 1-1. Dzeko, I think around the 20th, makes it 2-1. So Roma looks all right-ish. And in Mönchengladbach, Gladbach takes the lead. A nice cross from Lainer that Thuram hammers into the net. However, nothing is ever that straightforward with Gladbach in the Europa League, and they give up an equalizer a little bit later on. So it's 1-1, and Roma also. Nice cross at Roma that Sean Weissmann heads in, and it's 2-2 for in Italy. And Gladbach completely loses the plot, gets nervous like crazy, and a few minutes before the end, Bajak Shehir makes it 2-1. Now, Wolfsburg was also putting Roma a little bit in trouble, so if Wolfsburg would have won it, then Gladbach would have been through, but in the end, the leaders of the Bundesliga go out. Unbelievably, I did not expect that. I expected Roma to get the results that they need and Gladbach a result that they need. Bajak Shehir, and it's, even from an Austrian perspective, not that great because Başakşehir, the Turks, we are chasing Turkey, and that was the only points that Turkey made. So Turkey still is in the running, and they are kind of fending off Austria at the moment. Group K, Wolves, easy 4-0 over Besiktas. I think all four goals very quick succession in the second half. Slovan had it was 1-0 down, turned it around, but then Braga made three more to win 4-2 in Bratislava. So in that group, it's also those two, Wolves and Braga. Braga wins the group advancing. And the last one, United also against Alkmaar. A little bit surprising result, to be honest, and I have not looked at the lineups. But also in short succession, they score 4. And Partizan beats Astana. They were also 4-0 up, but it's 4-1. And get a final win. That group, United wins Alkmaar, Partizan, and Astana. So we are through these. I again made the table of the chances of the teams meeting. It is a lot more even than the Champions League, although you can clearly see the teams that have a lot of restrictions, let's say like Sporting especially, that of course all the opponents are a little bit more likely. For three Champions League teams, Olympiakos, Schacht and Leverkusen, all the opponents are possible, so that's why on this side it's all red, but it all works out fine. I'm taking now from the LASK perspective. LASK's most likely opponents are Getafe and Wolves, which I would not be too happy with. I honestly, Roma, I would love if we would have, and if I think about it, Roma, Wolfsburg, Frankfurt, and if I think about advancing, yeah, Ludogorets maybe. Well, I'm not Cluj, but I actually think this will be really, really tough opponents. Everyone says Apoel. I want to stay away from Apoel. But, you know, Sporting has the most likely results. I find it interesting that Salzburg is most likely to play against Sporting, but Sporting is definitely most likely to play against Arsenal or a different opponent. But, you know, I leave it up here. Maybe pause the video and study how you want. It's a very dense infographic and I don't want to go through all that. Well, let me know what you thought about the Europa League games so far. Give me a thumbs up if you enjoyed this video. I probably should do one about the history of LASK at one point, maybe in the winter break. And yeah, as I said, give me a thumbs up, drop a comment below and subscribe to my channel if you want to see more. And yeah, we'll talk about the draw very, very, very soon in the Europa League and the Champions League. And up until then, bye. Hey there, I hope you enjoyed this video. And if you did, here are some videos and playlists that would be of interest to you too. Also, please consider subscribing to my channel as it will keep you updated with all things that are rotating in my soccer universe. With that, I wish you a wonderful day. Bye.